most detailed information over a larger geographical area and at different altitudes.
So in order to understand how it all works, we have several aircraft that we have to fly. One is the one I'm standing on right now, the NASA DC-8. The DC-8's role is to measure the atmosphere directly. From this aircraft, we can measure literally over 100 different compounds in the atmosphere.
The airplane flies as easily at 500 feet as it does at higher altitudes. That enables us to do both remote sensing, which is using radars or LIDARs, as well as we can fly lower, we can do vertical profiles with our in-situ sensors, which is currently what we got mostly on this airplane.
In order to understand the atmosphere, there are many different molecules that we have to measure. The satellite will not see all of them. And so by being able to measure what the satellite will see and at the same time see all of the details, we can begin to understand what sources and what meteorologies and what combinations of conditions will affect what we see from space.
By combining detailed measurements from aircraft with those made by satellites, we can get a better picture of pollutants in our atmosphere.
So this aircraft carries instruments that work just like the satellite instruments. The higher we fly, the wider the patch of Earth we can see.
During the campaign, NASA King Air aircraft will mimic the measurements future satellites will make.
We fly at about 28,000 feet, and at that altitude, we see about a 5 mile wide patch of ground. It's like mowing the grass. We're just trying to cover a patch on the ground continuously and make a map of what the pollutant distribution looks like.
So we have a small King Air aircraft flying above all throughout the day, measuring the way the future satellite will measure air quality. Meanwhile, the DC-8 flies underneath, showing what the distribution of pollution is above the ground. That allows us to understand how to connect what the satellite sees with what's at ground level.
Chorus AQ has in its team two smaller aircraft equipped with atmospheric chemistry measuring instrumentation, a King Air from NASA Langley Research Center, and a King Air provided to the Korean National Institute for Environmental Research by Hanzo University.
Hanzo King aircraft is relatively smaller than DC-8 in NASA. It can freely access source of pollution and measure air quality capital territory that cannot approach using DC-8.
Working all together, scientists from the Chorus AQ campaign will provide valuable data and test the technologies needed to better understand air quality and the flow of pollutants within our atmosphere.
We can only fly the planes for a very short period, but the details that you get from the aircraft help inform the observations from space and from the ground and how models can interpret those observations.
From this mission, we'll have better models and better mission data for Asia, and so we'll be able to extend the usefulness of this well beyond South Korea to other developing cities around the world.
We have the tools to study our atmosphere. Now, let's go exploring.
Hey everybody, this is Beck, and I am a maker of music. And like the great Sun Ra said, space is the place.
And I'm Farah, I work at NASA, and I use AI to explore Mars.
And I brought a few friends along who know something about artificial intelligence.
Hi, I'm John.
Hi, I'm Isabel. We are both artists working with NASA using artificial intelligence.
This is Ask NASA.
Yes, So Beck, you just released a set of new music videos using a lot of NASA imagery, and I grew up loving space, and obviously those images are used by scientists. What inspires you about space and how you came up with this idea?
Well, the title of the record came from a video game, a really primitive video game from the 80s called Asteroids. When the asteroids were going to kill you and they were just about to collide with your spaceship, that you would hit this button and it would make you disappear and reappear somewhere else in the galaxy. And I always wondered what that button was called, and I looked it up one day and it was called hyperspace. So I got my mind thinking into music and song ideas. Because I think in some way, I think of music as sort of a hyperspace button. You know, it's something that we press play on a piece of music and it takes us somewhere out of our lives, out of our circumstances. But I did like the feeling of the music, that there was this sort of thread of outer space, kind of wide vista of space and time, you know, existing in the songs.
Artificial intelligence is the ability for machines or computers to make autonomous and intelligent decisions. That can look like recognizing patterns or analyzing images or learning certain behaviors and then mimicking them.
I mean, right away when we heard hyperspace, we thought we have to use AI for this. Beck was already creating a sonic environment that went to like the edges of our understanding and the way that we see. And that's something that we're most excited about working with AI with, that it expands our modes of thinking. And then just the title, hyperspace, literally means to go beyond three dimensions. The one that we use for this particular project, it literally works in a 512 dimensional space. The process begins with the AI training on the images. So if we showed it just a few hundred, it wouldn't know that much. But what was so great about working with NASA's decades deep, you know, archive of knowledge is that it could really learn. So for weeks and weeks, the AI trained on as many images as we could show it. I think in the end, it looked at over 25 million images. Sometimes that was multiple times looking at the same images to try and understand these images.
Yeah, basically imagery of anything in our solar system is how we get started in the process of exploration, right? And so when we first went to Mars or when we sent Cassini to Saturn, we had some thoughts about what we might find based on that imagery, and that's what allows us to really focus down on the type of science we're going to do.
I worked a lot on the database creation, and I feel almost like I could draw a picture of the galaxy now just from going, like anyone can do, just by working with the NASA websites and going through the archives. Like the AI was then able to take that and recognize colors that were happening a lot, recognize shapes that were happening a lot. I remember when it first showed us what it thought Saturn looked like, I was blown away.
Yeah, and even then, seeing these images and getting all the info, it is overwhelming, isn't it? I mean, we're talking about other worlds, we're talking about other realities we probably won't ever get to experience in our lifetimes. This is the closest we'll come to touching the unknown. This project is so interesting because it really came out of the theme of the record. I would have loved the idea of taking sounds from these missions in space and putting them into the music itself.
Literally build its own map. It can then identify different types of obstacles and slopes, and based on that and its knowledge of where it's able to drive, it decides on the path.
the Mars database was in one of the easiest ones because it's where we have the most high resolution imagery. It's been so well captured from so many different points of view.
We've seen the soil on a terrestrial level, and then we also have imaging of Mars from above, and looking through this data set of massive data set of incredible images. Once we trained the AI on that, it was able to kind of produce such vivid, strange imagery, because Mars itself, I think, is so much more complex and so much more deep and varied than we imagine it is.
Okay, so one more cool feature about the Perseverance rover is that it can also act as a scientist. The rover can look at the environment around it, look at all the rocks, and say, hey, this rock over there looks really cool. Let me image it, use my laser to zap it, and figure out what's under that surface, send all of that data back to the scientists. So it allows us to essentially have scientists on Mars making decisions without having humans in the loop here on the ground.
I think, to me, the idea of space is a bit overwhelming and awe-inspiring. Just the idea of listening to a piece of music and we go somewhere else, our lives change. You know, it's a mirror to this other idea of space and space exploration, and letting the imagery of these other worlds, these unknown places with this music, I think has been really satisfying to me. It's in the other lasting nothing. You know, I feel really fortunate to have you all open your doors to me and my music, and for us to go somewhere with it that was unexpected, even for me.
Let's make a space or something.
Here, let me get my video up.
Sorry, guys.
We'll get there.
NASA. This is Ask NASA. I mean, that would be the show tune way. There's all kinds of guitars. This guitar is actually from 1901, and it has these ivory pegs. All right, so these are some vintage keyboards. And this is the 808, which is responsible for the sound of all trap music. This is the Moog. And this is responsible for most of the music of the 80s. There's a couple of pedals that I use. Little bits and bobs.
Exploring the universe is a daunting task. There are often immense challenges that must be overcome before even setting out on a mission. The Ionospheric Connection Explorer, or ICON, has faced multiple barriers that have delayed its journey to study the frontier of space, the dynamic zone high in our atmosphere, where Earth's weather meets space weather. But before we can reap the benefits of its scientific research, ICON must launch successfully. The ICON team's can-do spirit will be repeatedly pushed to its limits while striving for a long-awaited and hard-earned T-Zero.
A successful space launch requires flawless execution of a highly complex machine, and Pegasus ICON is no different. During previous attempts, we observed some anomalous readings. We worked through that with NASA and implemented corrective actions. This will ensure a highly successful mission.
Perseverance is doing something despite difficulty or delay in achieving success. It's a required virtue when the subject is spaceflight and the focus is a successful mission.
Just like any rocket, you have your share of problems that you run into, because this is rocket science after all.
Issues arose, but dedication never wavered. The entire ICON team knew this was about more than just rocket science. It was about the payload, science that would benefit all of humanity. As with every NASA program, giving up is never an option.
It has taken us months, hours, days to really resolve a lot of these issues with this integrated team. And thankfully, we were able to get through them, and here we are getting ready to launch.
Thank you. The ionosphere is not only the area through which radio communications and GPS signals travel, it's also the space.
Check, check, check. Is he coming through?
Yep.
I can't tell. Hello, hello? Blah, blah, blah. Blah, 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 blah. Wah, wah. Can I get my second monitor visible somehow? Can I get my second monitor visible somehow? Because
oh yeah, over here in TriCaster.
Yeah. Because I don't need to see anything else. I mean, that's kind of the most important thing for me. I don't care about watching NASA TV. Okay.
Well, we can't. That's feeding TriCaster, so we can't put it anywhere other than in the.
Well, I need to like maximize that window. Let's see. Let's see if we can do this.
I can put you. Well, I can put you in program.
Do you see my mouse? I don't even know where it is.
I can put you in program, but that's about as good as I can get.
Letting me know.
Oh, and we can put you over here.
Oh, you already know then.
Cool. Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm gonna pin this.
Are they hearing us?
No, you have to do it.
What do I have to do? I'm sorry. All right.
Oh, you are mic'd up. Great.
Yeah, I'm mic'd up.
Okay, good.
And if someone puts in the chat a question relevant to what you're talking about right at the moment, I might pop in.
Okay.
That's okay.
Okay. Yeah, go for it.
Great.
Okay, check, 1, 2, 3, check. Hello, hello. We're going live. What's happening? Everything look good? Okay, cool, thanks.